According to see the reticular formation and the states in which every person is, we have mainly four stages. We have the serotonin modulating system, the norepinephrine modulating system, dopaminergic pathway, and acetylcholine pathway. So the acetylcholine pathway is involved in many things, like in the sleep, in things like movements, etc. And we have seen many of the cholinergic pathways and what happens if we damage these nucleus, like the Meynert nucleus. This produces Alzheimer's disease, etc. But the acetylcholine is released in the pontomesencephalic tegmental area of the brain and goes to every place. There is not much to say in this video about this. At the end, we will do some integration about all these neurotransmitters in accordance to the diseases. I want to focus more on these other three. In norepinephrine, is released in the locus ceruleus. This means blue, and is around the pons, near the fourth ventricle. Here we have release of, well, here the norepinephrine is produced and is released to every place. And when we have a lot of norepinephrine, noradrenaline, is when we are active and we are like focusing in something. This is also the eureka moment, in a sense, not as much as in dopamine that we will see, but is the admirative capacity. So norepinephrine is to what we put attention. If we can put attention to something that we fear, if we were scared about snakes, we will be just thinking about snakes and looking around and paying a lot of attention. But we can also pay a lot of attention if we know that something that emotional is going to, or that is an exciting moment, and so the patient is only thinking about that, or if a student when knows how to derivate some mathematical equation or something, besides the dopamine that we will see later, that person is releasing norepinephrine. Has the admirative capacity when says something like, oh, I already understand, it was amazing, something like that. This is, besides the dopamine, is also norepinephrine release. And the norepinephrine is a little bit of being in beta versus alpha. Is in alpha we are just like receiving information, and in beta we are actively thinking in that. It is like listening a lecture versus that is being in alpha. And being in beta is, alright, I'm listening to the lecture, but constantly I'm thinking like questions about what I'm listening, or I think that now I'm going to repeat that lesson, so I have many more questions, because I'm actively thinking, how am I going to say this? And so the person understands more if the person is the one that is going to give the lecture, for example. So alpha is just listening to the lesson, beta is listening to the lecture and thinking questions about that, or analyzing a lot what is listening, or if the person is doing a video about the lecture or is going to give the lecture, that is being in beta. Norepinephrine is being in beta, and in alpha is just the paying of attention. Now, the serotonin controls the mood, behavior, and the emotional behavior, and is the industriosity. Serotonin is active in aggressiveness and induction of sleep, but also when we're doing something that is very industrious, like the bird that is constructing like the nest, etc. When the bird is recollecting the sticks or part of the tree, etc., is releasing serotonin, is doing actively something. So also when we are doing something that is very active, we have release of serotonin. At the end of the video, we'll see damage or diseases that are associated with decreasing serotonin. Dopamine is one of the most important. The serotonin is produced on the raphe nucleus. Serotonin is 5-hydroxytryptamine produced by the or from the tryptophan. Now, dopamine is produced in the substantia nigra and in the ventral tegmental area, and can go to every place, but one of the most important is the nucleus accumbens. We have a lot to talk about the nucleus accumbens and the reward pathway, reinforcement pathways, many, many things. In this video is just a little bit of the first experience about talking the dopaminergic pathway. Here, the nucleus accumbens, when there is released of dopamine in the nucleus accumbens, the patient feels extremely happy. This can happen when there is something that increases the reproduction success of the individual. For example, if he's obtaining food, that then that individual can grow up and then reproduce, or if is obtaining a partner, etc. So there are direct mechanisms that release dopamine on the nucleus accumbens. Now, there are secondary stimuli that release dopamine in the nucleus accumbens, like every time a person is happy, extremely happy, is because it's releasing dopamine in the nucleus accumbens. Compare one person that is very happy because someone of the football game won, and a person that is extremely happy because now understand quantum physics, something like that. There is no comparison at all, but in each case there is release of dopamine, and it's a secondary stimuli because it is not directly this stimuli that is doing that the person releases dopamine. Is not directly contributing to the reproductive success, but at the end this would be, for example, we have a can of food and we cannot open it, but if someone is going to obtain something to open it, it's releasing dopamine when obtained that thing because knows that they could eat and then reproduce, etc. So we have secondary and primary stimuli, and is this dopaminergic pathway what determines the norepinephrine pathway and the serotonin pathway. So dopamine released on the nucleus accumbens is what determines to what a person is going to pay attention and to what is going to be industrious about. So if, for example, in the bird, the release of dopamine happens when it's constructing the nest, then the serotonin would be also released when it's constructing that. So not only we have these neurotransmitters that controls everything, but also dopamine controls these pathways. Now, the reticular formation or ascending reticular formation refers only to norepinephrine and serotonin. We will see now damage or well diseases associated with these decreases in neurotransmitters. We have anxiety disorder, depression, schizophrenia, Alzheimer, Huntington disease, and Parkinson disease. We have acetylcholine, dopamine. Let me put GABA. GABA is a inhibitory neurotransmitter. Serotonin and norepinephrine. So, remember that in Huntington's disease, there is damage to the nucleus accumbens, and the nucleus accumbens contains GABAergic and cholinergic neurons. So, in Huntington's disease, there is decrease in acetylcholine and GABA. Also, there would be decrease in acetylcholine in Alzheimer. In Parkinson's disease, is the opposite to Huntington's disease. So, there would be increase in acetylcholine. Dopamine would be decrease in Parkinson's. That's the Parkinson's disease is decreasing dopamine because there is damage to the sustancia negra. Huntington is the opposite, so Huntington would have increased dopamine. Depression certainly has decreased dopamine. The person is not happy. And schizophrenia has a lot of dopamine. We will talk a little bit of schizophrenia in some limbic pathways. Then the GABA. GABA certainly is decreased in anxiety because GABA is the inhibitory neurotransmitter. His patient is completely anxious. And there is maybe decreased GABA in schizophrenia patients. Now, serotonin is decreased in anxiety, depression, and Parkinson's disease. And norepinephrine certainly would be increased in anxiety and in Alzheimer would be decreased. So now let's talk about the dopaminergic pathways. Dopaminergic pathways. We have the mesocortical, mesolimbic, nigrostriatal, and tuberoinfundibular. Tuberoinfundibular is just, remember that dopamine inhibits the release of prolactin. This is the tuberoinfundibular pathway from the hypothalamus to the pituitary gland. If there is a blockage of this pathway, there is no dopamine that goes to the pituitary gland, and so there is a release of prolactin. The nigrostriatal pathway is where the antipsychotic medications produce the pyramidal symptoms, so tardive dyskinesia, akathisia, acute dystonia, etc., is due to side effect of antipsychotic medications in this pathway. Mesocortical pathway is when the patient with schizophrenia has the negative mood effect or negative affect is due to the mesocortical pathway. And the mesolimbic are the positive symptoms of schizophrenia, the hallucinations. So the antipsychotic medications work on the mesolimbic and in the nigrostriatal pathway. In mesolimbic is the reason for which we give antipsychotic in order to decrease these positive symptoms. But as a side effect, there is also action of antipsychotic medications in the nigrostriatal pathway.